As computer scientists began trying to develop intelligent machines in the 1950s, two different approaches started to emerge. The first approach, what we now call symbolic artificial intelligence, was inspired by the way humans reason about problems, and sought to encode knowledge and logic into computers. An early example was Logic Theorist, a program designed in 1956 by Alan Newell and Herbert Simon. Logic Theorist was programmed with a basic set of logical rules, and could use those rules to prove logical theorems. But while proving logical statements was achievable by symbolic AI systems, solving other problems, especially as they related to human perception, was more difficult. Humans can look at the physical world and recognize patterns, like telling apart shapes or letters, but it's not obvious how to take that ability and encode it as a logical formula. To solve these kinds of problems, a second approach to artificial intelligence, called connectionism, was also developed. This approach to AI built on the work of the artificial neurons described by McCulloch and Pitts. The idea was that if we could construct computers structured like how the human brain is structured, with networks of interconnected neurons and information represented by those connections, then maybe computers could learn to replicate human intelligence as well. Central to the effort to make this idea a reality was the perceptron, a computerized model based on the brain that had the ability to learn, first developed by Frank Rosenblatt in 1957. Rosenblatt developed a number of variants of the perceptron model, but one of the simple versions designed to emulate human vision looked like this. The model consists of three layers of units, where you can think of a unit as a digital representation of a neuron of the brain, storing some number that corresponds to the neuron's activity. The perceptron model starts with a layer of sensory units, which are inspired by the retina of the eye. The units respond to light, so that based on whatever visual pattern the perceptron is looking at, sensory units that correspond to that pattern will become activated. If we were trying to teach a perceptron to learn to identify shapes, like circles and squares and triangles, then we need the perceptron to understand which combinations of sensory units are meaningful for classifying particular shapes. But visual patterns might be in different positions and sizes and orientations, which makes it hard to know which sensory units should be associated together to represent a particular shape. Rosenblatt's solution to this was to try many different associations at random. In his perceptron, he introduced a second layer consisting of association units. Each association unit took input from a random set of sensory units and then produced an output, 0 or 1 in this case. To understand this behavior, let's focus on one association unit and the sensory units that act as its input. The connection between each sensory unit and each association unit is either excitatory or inhibitory. Excitatory connections mean that the sensory unit activating makes it more likely that the association unit will activate. Inhibitory connections mean that the sensory unit activating makes it less likely that the association unit will activate. When the perceptron receives input, some of the sensory units will activate. The association unit adds up how many of the active inputs have excitatory connections, and then subtracts the number of active inputs that have inhibitory connections. If the resulting total is greater than some fixed threshold, the association unit fires or becomes activated. The result is that each association unit will respond to a particular type of pattern in the input. One might respond when there's activity in a particular corner, and another might respond when there's activity along one side of the input, but not another. These associations are completely random, but the hope is that some combination of many different associations will be able to learn to classify patterns. That brings us to the third and final layer of Rosenblatt's perceptron, the response units. The response unit represents the final classification. We might have one response unit that we want to fire when the input is a square, one response unit that should fire when the input is a circle, and one response unit for triangular inputs. These units work similarly to the previous layer. Each response unit takes input from a random selection of association units and each connection between association unit and response unit has some initially random value, which we often call a weight. To determine if the response unit will fire or not, we consider which of the association units fired, and then add up the weights of those connections. If the sum of those values is greater than a threshold, often zero, then the response unit fires. The problem with the approach so far, of course, is that every decision we've made has been random. The connections between the sensory units and the association units, whether they're inhibitory or excitatory, and the weights between the association units and response units have all been generated randomly. So there's no reason to expect that this perceptron would be able to do something as intelligent as recognizing shapes. But what allows the perceptron to be effective is that it has the capacity to learn. Rosenblatt experimented with multiple possible algorithms to allow perceptrons to learn, but the essential idea is this. For each response unit, we want it to learn how each of its inputs should be weighted in order to produce the correct result. So our goal is to modify the weights by training the perceptron with data so that the perceptron produces the correct result as often as possible. Here's how we do it. We show the perceptron an input and see whether the response unit classifies it correctly. If the classification is right, then we don't change anything. But if the classification is wrong, then we want the perceptron to learn from its mistake. Say the response unit concluded that the pattern was a square, when in reality it wasn't. That means the weighted sum of the active connections exceeded the threshold, but it shouldn't have. The weights were too high. So we learn from this, and we adjust all of the weights that were active for that training example by decreasing them by a fixed amount, called the learning rate. Likewise, if the response unit concluded that the pattern wasn't a square, but in reality it was, that means the weights were too low. So we take all of the weights that were active for that training example and increase them by the learning rate. By giving the perceptron hundreds of training stimuli and adjusting the weights over time, eventually the perceptron learns to fairly reliably identify certain kinds of patterns. Over time, Rosenblatt and other computer scientists developed and iterated on the perceptron model. So let's take a look at what we often think of now when we talk about a modern perceptron. Remember that the only learning in a perceptron is in the weights between the association and response layers. The connections from the sensory units are random and don't learn from data. As a result, we can capture the essence of perceptron learning by focusing only on association units and a single response unit, which we can call the input and output of our perceptron. Instead of the input layer being entirely binary, we can represent more possible inputs by allowing the inputs to take on any real numbered value. Now, to calculate whether the output fires, we take a weighted sum of the inputs. Take each input value and multiply it by the weight of its connection. If the sum exceeds a threshold of 0, the perceptron outputs a 1, otherwise it outputs a 0. Allowing real-valued inputs also changes how we train a perceptron. Before, we adjusted each active weight by a fixed amount, the learning rate. Now that the inputs can take on any real values, we can be more intelligent with how we learn. We'll instead adjust each weight by the learning rate multiplied by the corresponding input. In other words, for inputs with a larger magnitude, we'll make bigger changes to the weight. And for inputs with a smaller magnitude, we'll make smaller changes to the weight. This makes sure we're focusing our changes on the inputs that mattered most for that training example. In modern perceptrons, we'll often also see models with an extra value added to the weighted sum before deciding if the output fires or not. This term is called a bias, and it effectively lets the perceptron learn what the right threshold should be, instead of using a fixed threshold all the time. The bias is sometimes represented as an extra value added after the weighted sum, but it's often convenient to instead represent it as just another weight of an input whose value is always 1. The math works out to be the same, but this way makes it a little clearer that we learn the bias value just like we learn any of the other weights. Using perceptron models like these, computers can learn to identify many kinds of patterns, but they can't identify all patterns. That idea was famously described in a book on perceptrons published in 1969 by computer scientists Marvin Minsky and Seymour Papert. They described how the perceptron could learn to classify perfectly only when the data is linearly separable. What does that mean? Well, the perceptron decides its output by taking a weighted sum of its inputs, also known as a linear combination of its inputs. In 2D, you can think of a linear combination as a line separating the two categories. In higher dimensions, it would be a plane or hyperplane. So the perceptron can only learn to classify between two groups if it's possible to draw a linear boundary between those two groups. That's true for some datasets, but for other datasets, it's not possible. There's no linear boundary that separates the two groups perfectly. Even some simple functions aren't linearly separable. For example, the exclusive OR function, which outputs a 1 when exactly one of its inputs is 1, and outputs a 0 otherwise, isn't linearly separable. There's no line that separates the 1s from the 0s. So, given this limitation, how can we train computers to learn more complex patterns? The answer lies in adding layers to the neural network. Taking our perceptron and adding a new hidden layer in between the input and output, where the hidden units also compute weighted sums and fire based on a threshold function, lets us classify patterns even if they're not linearly separable. The tricky part is that now the learning procedure isn't so simple. We have two sets of weights to learn, the weights between the inputs and the hidden layer, and the weights between the hidden layer and the output. And if we added more hidden layers to the network, the challenge only grows. In the 1950s and 1960s, we knew that multi-layered neural networks like this had the potential to learn sophisticated patterns, but we didn't know how to teach them to learn. That's what we'll be exploring next, as we continue our journey through the origins of artificial intelligence and machine learning.